Penguin Random House Audio presents The Haunting of Maddy Clare by Simone St. James. Read for you by Billie, Fulford-Brown. For Adam. Chapter 1. London, 1922. The day I met Mr. Gellis, I had been walking in the rain. In the morning, unable to face another day alone in my flat, I wandered through the bustle of Piccadilly, the collar of my thin coat pulled high on my neck. The air was swollen with cottony drizzle that did not quite fall to the ground and pressed my cheeks and eyelashes. The lights of Piccadilly shone garishly under the lowering clouds. The shouts of the tourists were loud against the grim silence of the business people and the murmurs of strolling couples in the square. I stayed as long as I could, watching the bob of umbrellas. No one noticed a pale girl, with cropped hair under an inexpensive and unfashionable hat, her hands plunged in her pockets. Eventually, the mist resolved itself into rain, and even I turned my reluctant steps home. Though it was only noon, the sky was near dark when I opened the gate and hurried up the walk to my small and shabby boarding house. I climbed the narrow stairs to my room, shivering as the damp penetrated my stockings and numbed my legs. I was fumbling for my key with chilled fingers and thinking of a cup of hot tea when the landlady called up the stairs that there was a telephone call for me. I turned and descended again. It would be the temporary agency on the line. They were the only ones with my exchange. I had worked for them for nearly a year, and they sent me to one place or another to answer phones or transcribe notes in ill-lit, low-ceilinged offices. Still, the work had dried up in recent weeks, and I was painfully short of funds. How fortunate I was, of course. I would have missed their call had I come home only 5 minutes later. In the first floor hallway, the house's only telephone sat on a small shelf, the receiver lying unhooked where the landlady had left it. I could already hear the echo of an impatient voice on the other end.
"Sarah Piper?"
came a female voice as I raised the receiver to my ear.
"Sarah Piper, are you there?"
"I'm here," I said. "Please don't hang up." It was the temporary agency, as I had suspected. The girl sounded flustered and impatient as she explained what had come up.
"A writer," she told me, "writing a book of some sort, needs an assistant. Wants a meeting with someone today. He wants a female."
I sighed, thinking of fat, sweaty men who liked a succession of young ladies in their employ. Normally, I'd be sent to an office to begin work right away, not to a personal meeting. "Is he a regular client?"
"No, he's new. Wants to meet someone this afternoon."
I bit my lip as my stomach rolled uneasily. Temporary girls were easy targets for any kind of behaviour from a man, and we had nearly no recourse without getting fired. "At his office?" She huffed her impatience.
"At a coffee house. He was specific about meeting in a public place. Will you go?"
"I don't know," I said.
"Look."
She had an edge in her voice now.
"I have other girls I can call. Are you going or not?"
To meet a man alone in a coffee shop? Yet my rent at the boarding house was 2 weeks past due.
"Please," I said. "This isn't a matchmaking service." "What's to lose?" she replied. "If you don't like it, I'll give it to the next girl."
I looked out the window, where rain now streaked down. I pictured the girl at the other end of the phone, bored and brassy and fearless. A girl like that wouldn't think twice. It was girls like me who thought twice. About going back out in our only good set of clothes. About meeting unknown men in unknown places. About everything. I took a breath. I could go back to my damp little flat and sit at my window, thinking and drinking endless cups of tea. Or I could go out and meet a stranger in the rain.
"I'll be there," I said. She gave me the coordinates and hung up. I stood for only a moment, listening to the water on the windows and the sound of coarse laughter in one of the first floor rooms. Then I went back out to the street.
I don't suppose they told you much,
the young man across from me said as he poured his tea.
I told them as little as I could.
He was nothing like I had pictured. Young, perhaps 25, the same age as I. His dark blonde hair was not slicked down, as was the fashion, but worn longish and windblown, as if he combed it in the morning and forgot about it. Quick intelligence gleamed in his grey eyes, the wry set of his face, and the eloquent movement of his hands. The coffee house he had brought me to was in Soho, and the bohemian atmosphere of it matched his style. An olive-green coat of soft, well-worn wool over a white shirt unbuttoned at the throat. He blended perfectly in a place like this, with its offbeat paintings and thin, sullen waitresses. It was I who was out of place here. I never came to Soho. Its reputation was too wild, too artistic for me. But as I sipped coffee that made my mouth burn with flavour and watched Mr. Gellis' fascinating smile, I ceased to care. I wrapped my cold hands around the cup, curled my sodden toes in their cheap shoes, and managed to smile back. Not much, I agreed. They said you are a writer. He laughed.
I hope you didn't get too excited. I don't write lurid books or anything of that sort, just dry, academic books.
I don't read lurid books.
You won't be disappointed, then.
He dropped a lump of sugar in his cup.
A lady who doesn't read lurid books is promising. I asked for someone intelligent.
I blinked. The agency thought me intelligent. I doubted it. Likely I had been chosen because I was currently available. Still, the compliment warmed. I took off my hat and quickly ran my fingers through my earlobe-length hair, which was curling a little in the damp. Do you require a secretary? I can transcribe. He leaned back in his chair.
There may be some of that.
He tapped his fingers on the tabletop and looked out the window, as if thinking. I watched his clean, debonair profile with the beginnings of warm pleasure. His presence was so comfortable, so easy, I was suddenly glad I had come. Mr. Gellis tapped his fingertips on the tabletop again and turned to me. He seemed always in motion, as if his thoughts could not sit still.
I confess I'm not entirely sure how to approach this. What I need done may seem rather strange.
Some of my happiness drained away. Strange?
I met you in public for a reason,
he went on.
I specifically need a female, and I did not want you to feel uneasy, presented with something that might frighten you.
I was cold now. I beg your pardon? He reddened.
I'm terribly sorry. That came out wrong. I don't get out much socially, you know.
He sighed.
I'll let my notes do the explaining.
He pulled a large notebook from the leather satchel slung over the back of his chair and slid it across the table to me. The notebook was well used and full. I could see corners turned down, the edges of glued-in clippings, extra pages folded and stuffed between leaves. I opened it to the first page, which contained a newspaper clipping about a haunted house in Newcombe. In the margin next to the clipping was a neat set of handwritten notes. I turned to the second page and found more notes, in a careful hand that was squared and bold and masculine. I read the notes for a long moment, then I looked up. This is...
Yes.
An eyewitness account of a ghost.
Yes.
I felt his gaze on me as I flipped through more pages. It was a notebook of hauntings, one after another. So, you research ghosts?
I document them.
He rubbed a hand through his hair.
Well, what do you know? I'm so used to it, I don't really think of it anymore. But it sounds strange said out loud, doesn't it?
He dug into his bag again and handed me something else. A book. I took the slender volume and read the title. Accounts of Haunted Properties in the North of England by Alistair Gellis. I looked up at Mr. Gellis, who was staring modestly down and stirring his tea with a spoon.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.